Hello and welcome to our special show, Morgan Stanley's Worldview. This show comes to you from the sidelines of the Morgan Stanley 19th India Investor Conference, and we start with a bang. We start with their India strategist, well-known face in India, Ridham Desai. You know, I have a summary of your recently written note, and this is looking very, very bullish. You expect earnings to compound at 20%, over the next 5 years, and Nifty to triple within 5 years. Mm-hmm. 30,000 index?
Yeah, I mean, let's put it into context. So between 03 and 07, Nifty earnings compounded at 39%.
Okay.
And the index was up sevenfold. So this is relatively modest in that context. We did that in 4 years. In 5 years, we'll triple. The context here again is that the profit share to GDP is at close to all-time lows. So profits have really fallen off, and it's a cyclical number. It tends to recover. I think the factors have been set up for a recovery. Consumption looks like it's on a recovery path thanks to the enormous work done on inflation, so real wages are turning. Therefore, you will start seeing some recovery in jobs. Exports, which were lagging and which were really a big drag for 2 years running, have recovered as well. Government infrastructure capex is actually doing quite well. It's about to hit all-time highs. So three out of the four legs which drive the economy are in place. The fourth and the only missing leg is private capex. But as a consequence of these three, as utilization rates climb in the next 12 months, we think capex will also recover next year. So I think we are in the midst of a cyclical recovery in the economy, which obviously is good for earnings. It's not going to go up in a straight line. There are various things that will happen over the next several quarters. But I think it's fair to assume that this is a well-entrenched bull market, and therefore there's considerable more upside for a long-term investor. For somebody who's looking at it from a 3 to 6 month perspective, I can give you a lot of problems that the market is going to face. But, we can come back later in this discussion.
I was going to start with that. I mean, valuations-wise, even with giving a very rich growth in the current year, we will still be, 18 times, we are at very tall valuations. And some of the FMCGs, the favorite sectors that everyone likes, we are at 40, 60 times some of the good earnings numbers. If you take an HDFC bank, we are already at 4 times. If it's RBL, I think it'll be 5 or 6 times.
So valuations are not my concern, Latha. Okay. I think they're a little bit stretched in the mid-cap space, small-cap space. So I think that's a concern there. But let's look at valuations. And actually, valuations can be looked at in different ways. So I look at it relative to India's own history. Now, you cite PE multiples, but remember, earnings are depressed. So PE multiples invariably are going to look a little richer because the earnings are below normal. If you normalize earnings, then the PE multiple may not be as rich as it looks right now. So therefore, I look at it in terms of price to book, which doesn't deal with cyclicality in earnings. And on price to book, India is at about close to its long-term average. So it's not cheap in the conventional sense, but it's also not rich. These are not levels at which you can make a market call on valuations. See, valuations are useful only at extreme levels, when they are too low or too high. Otherwise, you have to use other things like sentiment, like growth, and other things to judge where the market is heading. Then again, if you look at India relative to US multiples, which is the bellwether market of the world, India's valuations are just off the 08 lows. Just off the 08 lows. It tells you how rich the US markets are. Okay, so again, everything is in the context of relative positioning. So valuations don't have an absolute context. So relative to the US, India is okay. Relative to EM, yes, the valuations are above average. That I think is kind of justified by India's superior growth and rising ROEs versus EM. I think EM has got more structural problems, so India's valuation premium is sustained. Versus bonds. So you look at the 10-year bond. 10-year bond is offering you 15 times earnings. 6.6%?
Yes.
Equities are 17 times. And 10-year bond only gives you a coupon for 10 years. Equity coupon continues beyond that. And the equity coupon is a growing one. The 10-year bond is a static coupon. Which one will you buy? The 10-year at 15 times or the equity is at 17 times?
So if you're a, exactly.
So if you're a long-term investor, that's where I think you want to be. As I said, mid-cap, small-caps, I think there's a little bit of a stretch there because there's an earnings recovery coming. And I think as you can go back in time, we tend to underestimate both a recession in earnings as well as a recovery in earnings. So the oft-repeated comment, especially I've seen it on your channel as well, is that, you know, for the last 7 years, analysts have started the year with 15-17% earnings growth and ended the year with nothing. It's quite possible that we continue to start at 15-17%, but we end differently from the last 5-7 years. And I'll again give you history. In 2004, analysts started with 15%, ended the year at 30%. So, you know, the reverse is possible if the growth cycle is turned.
I was going to ask you, does this feel like 2003-04, and you kind of partly answered it.
It feels more like 2004, not 2003. In 2003, the index multiple was 2.1 times book, and the P multiple was 10.
Okay.
It was a very, very juicy level, very different from today. In 2004, we were somewhere around 3 times book. And 17, 18 times earnings, and all through 04, 05, everybody kept complaining that valuations are rich and the market kept going up, but we did get big corrections along the way. Okay, so it's not like a linear straight line move that you're going to see even now.
2004, the rate hikes also started, but anyway.
So, Ridham, you know, if this scenario plays out of a 20% CAGR growth and, you know, whatever we say from 2003 to 2008, similar scenario plays out, this time what will lead this rally? Because every bull market has got different legs and different sectors, you know, taking the markets higher. This time, what are the assumptions?
So, I think, Nimesh, financials certainly look like the place to be.
Yeah, that shows
and
in your...
And consumer discretionary is the other place. Let me just talk about discretionary consumption first, and I'll come to financials. So, I think we're going to underestimate consumption in this country. And the reason for this is the fundamental change that's happening in the household psychology. So, there's a cultural shift that's happening. My father never borrowed money. I've never borrowed money. But everybody who's 20 and 30 something in the world in India is now looking to borrow money. There's a big way in which people have changed their mindset versus loans. What does borrowing money do? It advances demand. Okay. So we will underestimate consumption in a meaningful way, because if we look at nominal GDP growth as a guide to consumption, I think consumption will be ahead of it. There's a second thing that's happening in consumption is we are approaching a J curve in the per capita income. So if you look at India's consumption basket, 60% of it is food. But now from here on, when the consumption basket grows another 10%, 6% will not be food. Mm. Okay. Because that's only that much food you can consume. So the remaining 40 will grow at 10, which is 25%. So a lot of non-food consumption will grow quite rapidly as a consequence of these two factors. So I think we will underestimate discretionary consumption. And therefore, I think that's a sector to back for the medium term. As a consequence of household leveraging, I think there's going to be a big boom in retail loans.
Right.
And therefore, financials, I think, will also do quite well. In the financial sector, however, there is a lot of disruption that's likely to happen. That's coming from technology. It's coming from regulations. So those things will create, I think, some difficulty in picking the right stocks. But one narrative I think is quite clear is that the state-owned banks will lose market share. So sitting at 70%, I think they're likely to give up 10, 20, 30%.
So none of them on your list?
No, none of them on our list. You could trade in them, but I don't think you should invest in them.
Okay.
And the trading rallies can be quite powerful, as we've seen over the past few months. But then, you know, they'll probably give up performance as their valuations get full and the structural factors start impeding them. Because I don't think the government is in any hurry to put meaningful capital to work there. Mm. So they're starved of capital. And I think they will lose share to the privates and to the non-financials.
You spoke about government investment also being fairly rich. None of us talk, reflect that. We don't have the Larsons in your list or the ABBs or all those various road construction companies.
Yeah, there's a technical issue because our industrials coverage is in transition.
Gotcha.
So right now we don't have industrial stocks in coverage, but we'll soon have them.
Ridham, to take your call on financials forward, I think recently your team upgraded the NBFCs, the likes of M&M Finance and Shriram Transport. Without talking about individual stocks, broadly what is the sense on the NBFCs and why you like that space?
So there is a disparity in valuations. Some of them, I think, have turned quite attractive. and have fallen to 2x book. Yes. There are others that trade at 6x book. Right. And I think in a bull market, if you are looking for 1-year returns, there's always opportunity for you to switch from one side to the other side. And the other side plays catch up, and then you know you give up on one side, which is expensive. So that's exactly what we are doing as well.
Well, Ridham, on that note, we have to take a break. We are coming back with lots more questions to Ridham Desai.